Xiao and Orit Pelic. And just as a reminder, during the talks, please keep your, please, if you don't already have your full name in the Zoom, change it and so that you have your full name showing. That helps us when you ask questions in the chat, then the speakers can later get back to you and continue the conversation. And please mute yourself during the talk to avoid feedback. And if we're having bandwidth issues, we ask that you turn your video off. And remember, you can ask lots of questions in the chat, and those, the questions we don't get to will be emailed to our speakers later. And then afterwards, don't forget to hang around for the 15 minutes at the end where we open it up and people can ask questions just in general. So with that, I think we should probably get started, and we're excited to hear from Jie Xiao.
All right, thank you. Good morning, everyone. So I'm going to first start sharing my screen. All right. Well, I want to first take the opportunity to thank Sri, Mo, Meredith, and Kim for the invitation. I think this is a great platform to come together, stay connected, and also at the same time, learn something new. So what I'm going to talk about today is some of our work. I use the title, How to Make a Linear Stepping Motor in Bacteria. And you're going to see why I choose this title. So for many of you, I believe for this audience, many of you must be very familiar with how a stepping motor works. So here I'm just showing a schematic. You can see that the motor on the left that can rotate unidirectionally at a desired frequency. And if you couple this rotor with a winding shaft, then you can translate this rotational movement into a directional linear movement and to carry a cargo. So this is how, you know, mechanical engineer would design a stepping motor. But then what about cells? What about eukaryotic cells and prokaryotic cells? They also need to have motor proteins to carry cargo from one side of the cell to the other side. For eukaryotic cells, we know very well that there are lots of different motor proteins. This is a very well-known movie by Ron Bell and Paul Selving many years ago. This is a kinesin molecule carrying a lipid vesicle on a microtubule. This is powered by ATP hydrolysis. And this is really a directional movement. The motor just directly attached to the vesicle and carried, move along the track. But then for prokaryotic cells, the question is a bit more complex. And there is no motor protein in prokaryotic cells. There's no kinesin, no myosin, no dynein. So how do those very primitive prokaryotic cells carry out the function of a motor protein? So here I'm going to show you that some new discoveries that we and some other groups discovered in the past few years. So first of all, I'm going to show you one movie. So here you're looking at this ring-like structure. We are looking at a bacterial cell at the cross-section. This one protein is called FTSZ. We label it with a fluorescent protein. You can see that it forms a ring-like structure in the middle of the cell. And if I start playing this movie, you're going to see that this ring is really moving unidirectionally over and over again in the middle of the cell. And this, we think that this FTSZ protein could use a very special type of polymer dynamics to function as a motor protein. And this motor protein, this so-called motor, can also carry a cargo. Here is a one single molecule of an enzyme molecule that actually can move, if I play this one more time, can move from one side of the cell to the other side of the cell directionally. And this is purely driven by this directional motion of FTSZ. I'm going to tell you a little how this whole thing was discovered and what's the significance of this type of dynamics. So before that, I have to first talk about FTSZ. FTSV is a tubulin homolog. So here it's very important for bacterial cell division. At beginning of the cell division, it's, you know, all scattered inside the middle cell. And when the cell is about to divide, it comes to the middle and forms a ring-like structure. And gradually this ring-like structure shrinks in diameter and gradually divide the two daughter cells and scatter into the two daughter cells again. So here I'm showing you a movie. We labeled FTSV when GFP. You can clearly see that it's at the middle of the cell, gradually shrinking diameter and divide the cell. It looks like a ring structure. Okay. FTSV is actually a GTPase. It's a tubulin homolog. So it's one of the cytoskeletal proteins. It's very conserved. It's conserved in almost 99% of bacteria cells, and it also is highly, highly essential. So we know a lot about FTSV. Here, just a summary slide. So FTSV, we know that it's polymerized underneath this inner membrane, forms this ring-like structure, and FTSV is tethered to the membrane by two membrane tethers, ZipA and FTSA. And FTSV, because it has GTP hydrolysis activity, it also stochastically exchanges with the monomeric population in the cytoplasm through ATP, through GTP hydrolysis. Now, once FTSV forms this Z ring on the membrane, it recruits a whole array, more than 30 proteins in the cell to come to the middle of the cell and form this structure called, you know, this huge complex called divisome. And this whole divisome, many of those proteins, they are in the periplasm and they are responsible for cell wall synthesis. And this whole divisome work together to carry out cell division and cell wall constriction. So now if we look at the structure of this FTSZ ring using super resolution imaging, you would notice very immediately that the Z ring really is not a ring, it's a broken ring. It's discontinuous and heterogeneous. So this is the super resolution image and compared with this ensemble fluorescence image, you can clearly see the difference between those two. This work was done by a very talented postdoc, Jason, and this structure gave us some idea about the Z ring's function. So at that moment, when we saw this type of structure, we thought this is a little weird because if FTS Z ring is really functioning as a scaffold, it should be fairly stable. Why it's so discontinuous and heterogeneous? So then Xinxin, another postdoc, very talented postdoc in the lab, discovered another thing very interesting about FTSZ. So here again, we're labeling FTSZ using a GFP, and we're using turf illumination, so we're only seeing the bottom part of this ring. Now, if I play this movie, you're going to see that this cluster of FTSZ ring is really moving around and around directionally in the middle of the cell. If I draw a line across the middle of the cell, project over time, that's called a chymograph. Now you can clearly see that the intensity of this Z ring, this cluster, is zigzagging across the middle cell, indicating directional movement. And here, this is the movie again, where we can look at the ring head on. You can clearly see this directional movement. Then we can measure the rate of the leading edge and also the rate of the trailing edge. And that's basically the polarization, depolarization speed of FTSV polymers. And we found those two rates are very tightly coupled to the GTP hydrolysis rate of FTSZ. We purified, Xinxin purified all the mutants and characterized their GTP's activity and shown that this type of dynamics is really only coupled to the GTP hydrolysis rate. But then the question is, when we did the single molecule tracking, when we look at individual FTSZ molecule inside this cluster, they're completely stationary. So this is a paradox. Every single monomer in this whole Z ring is stationary, but this ring itself looks like it's moving. And the leading edge and the trailing edge, the speed are almost the same. Okay. So this is a very interesting and a unique property, a dynamic property of cytoskeletal proteins that has been seen in eukaryotes. It's called tradmining. So tradmining is the polarization of the polymer at one end and depolarization at the other end. As such that you can clearly see that this whole polymer looks like it's moving directionally but then the individual monomer inside this filament is not moving, it's stationary. So this is a very typical trapped meaning dynamics. Now, if you think about this, come back to the picture, what we know about FTS, the FTS is a highly conserved protein. And this phenomenon actually was first discovered in vitro by Martin Luce using purified FTS. You can clearly see this trapped meaning behavior. Then a few years later, our group and also Ethan Galler's group found that both in E. coli and Bacillus in Babel, we saw this behavior. And then very soon later on in other bacterial species, Staphylococcus and pneumococcus, you also saw this type of trapped meaning behavior. So this is a highly conserved dynamics that's intrinsic to the GTP hydrolysis activity of FTSZ. Okay, now you start coming back to this whole structure. So if this scaffold is a very broken, discontinuous, heterogeneous, and also it's moving, what's going to happen to all those proteins in the pyroplasm? Well, all those proteins move with it. So we start looking at some of those proteins, very essential cell wall proteins in the pyroplasm. The two proteins we looked at right now are, one is called FTSI, one is called FTSW. Both of those proteins are very essential for synthesizing the cell wall, the cell wall peptidoglycan. So we tapped those proteins and we did single molecule tracking. And this work is a collaboration between Xinxin and Pete DeBoer at Case Western, a very well-known geneticist. So this is the result. So Xinxin tapped FTSI, the enzyme in this pyroplasm with a red fluorescent protein and put this fluorescent protein in FTC wild-type background. So here on the left, this is a Z projection sound image. So you can see that it's basically just take this whole stack, chymograph stack, and add them together. You see this is a very smooth line, which indicating that this molecule is really moving from one side of the, one edge of the cell to the other edge of the cell. So this is a very directional movement. Again, I can play the movie. You can clearly see this one single FTSI molecule moving from one side to the other side. This is another one. You can clearly see this directional movement. And this type of movement is completely dependent on the FTSZ's GTP hydrolysis rate. In those FTSZ mutant, now you can see in the chymograph, FTSI just become slower and slower and finally stop. And on this Z projection, you only see one puncture, but instead of this smooth line indicating that FTSI in GTP is a mutant of FTSZ completely stopped moving. And we saw exactly the same phenomena on the other enzyme called FTSW. And if we measure all those speed, you can see that FTSI speed is almost the same as FTSZ speed. So they're very tightly coupled. So now we understand that FTSZ's trapped meaning dynamics that's powered by GTP hydrolysis drives the directional movement of FTSI and W, those enzymes in the pyroplasm. But then the question is, you must have thought of this. Even though FTSZ polymers looks like it's moving directionally, but the individual monomers, they are stationary. They are not actually moving. And also they are in the cytoplasm. How does that stationary FTSZ monomers in the cytoplasm translate into this directional movement of FTSWI in the pyroplasm? What type of mechanism could power this type of movement? So we worked with a theoretical modeler, Jie Xiao at Hopkins, and he said, you know, this actually sounds like a typical, a very classical Browning ratchet model. So in this Browning ratchet model, this is of course very much simplified. We have FTSZ or trapped meaning FTSZ polymer in the cytoplasm. And this polymer is attached to the membrane through the membrane tether of protein called FTSA. FTSA combines to the cytoplasmic tail of FTSI. FTSI is a pyroplasmic protein, but it has a transmembrane domain and also has a cytoplasmic tail. So we can characterize this system by looking at some very key features of this system. Those key features are, there are three key features. One is FTSI's diffusion. A single protein molecule on the membrane, they have a certain diffusion speed that can be characterized by diffusion coefficient. then there is an attraction force between I and FTSA, and here we're simplified just between I and Z, and that's an attraction force. Now, of course, your FTSA is also treadmilling and moving along. So we can parameterize all of those features and characterize, you know, the diffusion can be characterized by diffusion coefficient of FTSI. Then the attraction force can be characterized by binding energy between those two. And of course, we have FTSV's treadmilling speed. So Jen's idea is that when this whole system starts running, what happens is that when the trailing edge, the shrinking end of FTSV polymer start to dissociate, then that will create a bias of FTSI's diffusion so that FTSI will latch onto the next available FTSZ monomer. And as it's continuously falling off, then FTSI will just continuously latch onto the next one until at one point, because the diffusion is stochastic, you know, then it just diffuses away. Okay. So that's the basic idea of running ratchet. Because this treadmilling, it creates a bias to bias FTSI's diffusion and cause it to continuously entrap treadmilling FTSA from a polymer. So to examine this model, Jian first explored all those different parameter space, and he found something quite interesting. So this type of phenomena, the untracking phenomena, persistent untracking phenomena of FTSI can only happen within a certain parameter range. So for example, here we're in this left graph, we're fixing the binding energy between I and Z about the micromolar range, which is a very typical binding constant for proteins in bacterial cells. And you can clearly see only when you have a large enough binding, this one is by fixing FTSV's treadmilling speed at 25 nanometers per second, which is what we measured in wild type FTSV. So now you can see that only when you have a large enough binding potential above 5 kBT, which corresponds to a micromolar binding affinity, and also within a certain diffusion coefficient, usually, you know, between 0.001 and 0.1, then you would have this persistent entrapping. If you diffuse too fast, too slow, or binding energy too low, this would not happen. And in this graph, we're looking at the relationship between FTSV treadmilling speed and the diffusion coefficient. And also, again, we are fixing the binding potential here. Now you can see that only when your FTSV treadmilling speed is within a certain range, it can actually keep consistent in tracking. If FTSV goes too fast, then FTSI will not be able to catch up as well. And here there is one representative trajectory of the simulation of the model. So the red line is the shrinking end of FTSV. The blue line is the FTSI's trajectory. You can see that FTSI just simply hopping around at the trailing end, at the shrinking end of FTSZ, occasionally drops off but can catch up very quickly. And at one point, it just diffuses away just because this is the stochastic nature of those interactions. And using this model, we can pretty much reproduce what we observe in the experiment. So here on the y-axis, is FTSI's directional movement speed. On the x-axis is FTSZ's treadmilling speed. So the red is our experimental measurement coming from our single molecule tracking, and the black is by the simulation. So we were able to reproduce almost exactly the same experimental trend using the model. And based on this model, there are actually something even more interesting. So because when we do the model, we get every single trajectory of FTSI's molecule, the directional movement. And from those trajectories, so we can look at their duration, which is the time of FTSI molecule stays in tracking on FTSZ. How long does it stay on FTSZ shrinking end? And on the right, we are plotting the distance of the persistence run, which is how long the distance in nanometers one FTSI molecule to travel on FTSV. So on the left, you can see that this is a more or less a monotonic decrease. when FTS disease speed goes faster and faster, there are less and the time FTSI stay on FTSA becomes shorter and shorter. But on this graph, you can see there is a biphasic relationship. When FTSZ track meaning speed goes up, the distance goes up, but the one if FTSZ goes too fast, then FTSI cannot catch up anymore. So the average distance also drops. So this is a very particular relationship between FTSI's directional movement and FTSZ's track meaning speed that's predicted by this Brownian-Ratched model. So we want to see if this is indeed true for our system. So then Josh did a different type of single molecule tracking experiment. Here he's using nanopillars. So nanopillars is basically that we have those little holes, as you see here, little holes on an agar pad, then he can load the bacterial cell vertically into those holes. Then we can image from the cross section. Now you can see that here we label the Z-ring with another protein called the ZAPE. You can clearly see each individual cell in the hole when the Z-ring labeled. Then he used a different label, a halo tag, sandwich fusion of FTSI, which is completely fully functional. We label it with a red fluorophore. And then we can actually track FTSI's trajectory when on this cross section. This way we get the full trajectory and we can analyze all those individual segments and we can obtain the time for each segment and also the distance. So then we can compare those experimentally measured numbers with the model prediction. And here is what we have.
So Jie, you have 4 minutes left. Sorry, yes, I just wanted to give you the reminder.
Yeah, I saw that. Thanks, Mo. So of course you see this is our experimental results. Those nanopillar experiments are actually quite difficult to do. The throughput is really low. So we don't have too many data. Those data actually almost come from a half a year work from Josh. It's really a to the force. But you can see we can more or less, the experimental result can more or less recapitulate the model predictions supporting this Brownian ratchet model. So now if we come back to the picture, so I have shown you that FTSZ could use this GTPase activity hypotretamine dynamics to function as a new type of linear stepping motor. And here we have a directional movement caused by tretamine. We have a cargo, which is the peptidoglycan cell wall synthesis complex. We also have a track, which we are synthesizing the glycan strand. And when all those three criteria together, that's really qualified FTSZ as a linear, as a new type of linear stepping motor. But I would use the last 1 minute to tell you why FTSA would do this. I mean, this is a very interesting phenomenon. You know, all those polymer dynamics make it become a motor, deliver cargo from here to there. But why would you do that? It turns out, actually, FTSA use this type of dynamics to deliver the cell wall synthesis. For example, when all those enzymes are here, they're going to do a little work. And when FTSA move over here, all those enzymes will come here, do a little work. And as FTSA keeps going round and round, each time it's only 100 seconds. And the whole cell division process takes about 20 minutes. So there's a time scale separation. So in a way, FTSA is like a stir bar in the middle of the cell, carrying all those workers around and around and smooth their distribution so that you end up with a very smooth symmetric septum formation. But if you have a mutant, oops, now I think my computer is getting a little slow. But now if you have a mutant, what's going to happen here is that FTSA doesn't move, every single enzyme stay over there, then you only get to very concentrated synthesis on one side, but nothing on the other side. So then you end up with this highly asymmetric abnormal septum formation. So this we think is the major function of this type of tretamine dynamics of FTSA, and that is the whole goal of having this type of linear motor inside the cell. So when that ever stopped, this work is really done by our collaboration with Jen and also Pete, and also together with work from Josh and Xinxin and Jason, three major force driving the project forward. And I will thank you for attending the seminar, and I would love to take any questions. Oh, before I stop, I will just show that we have three great PhD programs, and especially if you're interested in this type of biophysical work, we have this PMB program in molecular biophysics that we I would really encourage you, if you know you have undergrads that applying for graduate school, please do consider us. All right, thank you.
Thanks, Jay. You have lots of questions.
I saw that too.
So it was, thanks for the exciting talk. And Andre Zakharov was the first question, and he asked, is this system constrained to 2D, or might it be evolving in 3D, allowing motion along a helical trajectory?
Very good question. This definitely can happen in 3D, because the geometry of the cell right now, in a way, it is a 2D on a curved surface, this type of movement. But if you don't have any other system to keep the ring only moving in the middle of the plane, it will become helical. And it's just a natural property of this, the, you know, the physics of this whole system, it will become helical.
Okay, then Meredith asked if Meredith said it seems like the bias diffusion in tracking model of FTSI following treadmilling FTSC is conceptually similar to the way kinetochores bind at the microtubule tips, contract the ends of depolymerizing microtubules. And she wonders if there's anything useful in that analogy.
I think absolutely. That's where we get our inspiration. Because, you know, their typical Brownian ratchet model, one is just the one protruding and pushing the membrane, and one is that tracking the shrink end. So this is absolutely, I think they're almost identical to each other.
And I'm gonna skip down maybe because we only have time for a few questions. But somebody, let's see. I'm not sure how to say your name. Huing Wang asked for Z-ring imaging. They think the bacteria should stand for imaging, and wondering how you get the bacteria vertically to image the ring.
Oh, well, you should ask Josh. I think Josh is here. It took him quite some effort. So naturally, if you just drop the E. coli culture on the glass, on the agar surface, they will go into the hole, but not at a very high percentage. And Josh has to perfect the art of pushing all those cells into the holes that have almost 100% loading efficiency. So he spent quite some time to optimize that.
Okay, and one of our last questions is how the Z-ring, they wonder, the Z-ring can be observed as a coil structure in 3D during cell growth, and they wonder if, how this relates to the simplified models of the Z-ring, or how this relates, I'm not quite sure how to ask this question, but about a 2D ring.
It doesn't really matter. It's the same polymer dynamics. I mean, the Z-ring, the Z polymer is quite soft, so it will conform to the curvature of the membrane most of the time, unless it's very, very sharp. So, the 2D ring, I suppose, just on one plane. 3D ring would be a helical structure, but the principles will be identical. You just change the, you know, segment length.
Thank you. And I'm not sure, do we have time for one more question, or should we move on to the next talk?
I think we do have time for time for one more question, because Jay started a little bit, you know, later.
Okay.
Than-
That's what I thought. So Rudra Biswas wonders what the biological function of the FTSZ ring is, or motion is.
Okay, yeah, that's actually what I devoted the last few slides for. So what we think the FTCZ's motion is really to regulate the morphology of the new septum formation because of this directional movement, it's served to homogenize the distribution of all those enzymes, make sure that they have even distribution of those enzymes, and trying to make sure that the enzyme would always stay over there and do the work. And the way you can think about this, you can think about FTCZ ring as a shuttle bus that drive around the construction site, carrying all these construction workers. And in a way, it's also a foreman. You know, if it sits at one side, you don't have enough workers, FTCZ would, you know, deliver those workers over there and make sure that they are going to patch up there. But if at some place the workers are too many, or you have too much going on, they could carry away some of those work and go to some other places. So in a way, it's really a spatial temporal regulation of cell morphology, cell pole morphology. That's our understanding right now, but there may be more.
Okay, and actually, I think maybe we have a really quick Ralph Bunshu wonders if your phase diagram would depend on the range of the FTSI-FTSZ interaction.
Yes. And, okay. Yeah, definitely. It does. So the first phase diagram I showed, actually the y-axis is the binding energy. You can see if your binding energy is less than 5 kBT, which corresponds to like a millimolar KD, then you're not going to see this. If the binding is too weak, this would not happen.
Okay, I think we've probably, it's time to move on to the next talk, but thanks for all your questions, and you can keep writing them, and at the end, we'll both send them to Jay, but also we will open up for everyone to ask questions in the final 15 minutes.